Welcome to our show today. We're excited. We have Tom Holmoe. He's kind of had a storybook career. I think if I could write a career for myself, it would probably be Tom's career. And he's played at BYU. He was an All-American there, and then he was drafted by the San Francisco 49ers. Played with them for how long?
7 years.
7 years as a defensive back. And then he went to Stanford, and then he became the head coach at Cal Berkeley. From 97 to 2001.
That's correct.
And now he's the athletic director at Brigham Young University. So he's had quite a career. He has 4 children. He's married. And we tried to drag his wife here, but we couldn't quite get her here.
She's busy with 4 children.
So, and 4 Super Bowl rings.
He has four Super Bowl rings. 3 as a player and 1 as a coach.
1 to match each of the children.
So we welcome you to the show.
Thank you. Tom. It's great to be here today.
It's great to have you here. Kind of what we're going to maybe just kind of go through what we're going to talk about today. We have Karen with massage. Blanca, we're doing her last weight loss segment. So we'll be doing that today. And then Dr. Fraser's doing a segment on headaches for our Ask the Doctor segment. And then Mike and Holly, we're not having a segment on with them today, but they are offering... With our Lose a Ton program, they're offering, for the next 10 people that sign up on our website, they're offering free training for 30 days. So that's a great, great offer, right?
Well, you can't beat that, because Holly's off to what, the national competition?
Yeah.
In bodybuilding?
Tomorrow she competes.
And she really knows her stuff.
So what's maybe we just mention a little bit about the other people that you have involved. You brought, what, 9 other people to, or so we now, we're up to... 1,073 pounds. So we're past halfway, and we have about 30 women involved, and you've brought 9 of those on.
At least. Now, a few more now. But we're trying to actually lose a ton collectively. You know, you have the saying of
good work.
Lose a ton of weight.
Sure.
And so we thought, wouldn't that be fun if we just added up all our pounds that we're losing and
right.
Lose a ton, and then maybe 2 tons or 5 tons, who knows?
It's a good place to start.
Isn't that fun?
So, Tom, you're in athletics. Tell us about your background, kind of your experience as a player, first as a player, then as a coach, and now as an athletic director. We promote athletics. We want to encourage the people in the audience to get their children involved in athletics. Maybe you can talk.
You know, Tom, it really all started back where I grew up in a town outside of Los Angeles, a suburb called La Crescenta in California. And it was a community that really... thrived on athletics. They had youth programs in all capacities, various sports, a lot of programs for young girls, where back in the 70s that wasn't common.
Now, did you have brothers and sisters?
I did. I had an older brother and an older sister. And I had an older brother who was 9 years older, who was a great athlete and kind of was a predecessor to me and blazed a lot of paths that made it easier for me. But in that community, we all played everything. We went from football, to basketball, to baseball, to track and field, to swimming, whatever it was. And everybody played, and there was opportunities for everybody.
Was that within the school and the parks?
Yes, both.
Both.
We actually had YMCA, which we played on the Saturdays, and we played in the schools during the school year.
Uh-huh.
And then in the summertime, we'd play in the league, in the city leagues. So there was marvelous opportunities, great leadership. We had volunteer coaches. We had parks and recreation administrators. And they gave kids an opportunity to play. When it wasn't organized, we just
play
at the park.
Now, what about your folks?
You know, my mom and dad were athletic when they were young, but they had an attitude with me and my brothers that if it made us happy, great. But they never forced anything on us.
That's good.
So we just enjoyed it, and there was never a burden to be successful.
And then you came to have a scholarship?
Yes. You know, I was in high school football, basketball, and track and field were my 3 sports, and was fortunate enough to earn a scholarship and to pay for my education, which in our community, it was important to get a good education. So there's a good balance between the education and the athletics. And I got a chance to get a scholarship, and I figured they're going to pay for me to go to school to play.
And to play.
That's a good deal. So I took it.
Tom and I were actually in the same major at BYU. We were both zoology majors. That's like, I struggled with zoology. That's a tough major. They say it's like the hardest major in the school, and you were pre-med, you actually took the MCAT to be able to be accepted into medical school, but then your football career kind of took off. So you
right. Well, when I went to the 49ers, I was drafted. My teammates, looking at my bio, saw I graduated in zoology. They thought I was going to be a zookeeper.
That's what BYU said. Are you going to be a zookeeper?
Zoology is biology. And it was just something that I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do when I declared my major, but the sciences, analytical, made me think. And I figured, you know what? I enjoy the biology part. It'll help me as an athlete. And then I thought, you know, maybe I'll get into medicine. But I played for 7 years, and that time to be into medical school passed me by.
Yeah. Now, what was it like to be drafted into the NFL? What an honor.
It's an interesting thing, Barbara, that when I was a young kid, we lived about 12 miles from the Rose Bowl. So my dream was always to play in the Rose Bowl. And I wanted to go to a Pac-10 school that played in the Rose Bowl every year, but I didn't get recruited to one of those schools. And so I would always go and see the Rose Bowl and turn it on and have these pangs because that was my goal. Well, when I got drafted, it was kind of wasn't a surprise I got drafted, but I really didn't ever think about being an NFL player. I thought about playing in the Rose Bowl. When I got drafted, all of a sudden, there I was. And so it really didn't intimidate me. And it's funny how I've been on Super Bowl championship teams, but my goal is still to be in the Rose Bowl. It's a funny thing. It's just when you're a kid and that's what you dream about, that's what you want to have happen.
That's so great.
So how do we instill in our youth these kind of experiences or the positive experiences? Because you were talking earlier about an experience your son had with a coach. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, I think that it's very important for parents to realize that they can't live their past lives in the present through their children. And that happens frequently. And you know, I had experience with I explained how my childhood and growing up in athletics was wonderful. But I had one of my sons when he was young, had a bad experience with a coach in Little League. He was 9 years old. And from that experience, it just made him not want to compete and play on a competitive level. So he bailed out of it. And it was okay with me. It was going to be a burden for him. And I wasn't about to carry a burden for him or make him carry that burden. But I have a great story. When I was back playing with the 49ers, I went back to my hometown and went to a track meet. And there was just to watch where I had played and seeing them compete. There was a young man that was in a race. It's a long story. I'll shorten it. But it was a two-mile race. And he got lapped twice in the race. And all these people finished the race in a clump. And it was very exciting. And then the starter of the race, the official, had to wait for about, it seemed like 10 minutes while this young man finished two laps. He walked off the track at the end of the race and no coach, no player, nobody came up to him and said anything. And as he walked close to me, I saw a man come walking up to him, gave him a big hug and said, "Son, that was a great race. You cut 30 seconds off your personal best." The smile on this kid's face, the father giving him a hug. That's what it's all about. It was success. It was fun. And they had a great relationship. So they'll remember that more than the parent that said, you know, you didn't run quick enough to come in third. You know, you get better. And that's what it's all about.
I think that's why we're such a proponent. We had some senior game Olympians on about 3 weeks ago, but we're such a proponent of adult activities because, like you say, so many people, they want to live their athletic careers through their children.
And yourself.
I'm like, yeah, do it yourself. Instead of watching sports, I don't mean to badmouth watching sports because you were playing, and I'm sure you enjoy the audience, but it's like we need more players versus people that are watching.
Well, there's so many sports and activities, recreation, that adults can do. And even right now, I've read articles about how elderly people can lift weights. And when you're 80 years old, that lean muscle tissue goes a long ways towards excellent health. And so there's something for everybody. You just have to be able to find it.
And what you said about success, it's so sad that we put success on if you win the game or win the medal, and as if that's the only way to success.
Exactly.
Because your wonderful story of the boy completing the race and the father being so proud of him that he had the fortitude to finish the race.
Right.
And that's certainly a measure of success.
It is. I mean, in this in Utah, we have the Utah Jazz, junior jazz program for girls and boys from 9 through high school. And when my kids come home from that, all three of my four have played, when they come home, I don't ask them who won. It doesn't matter. I ask them, did you have fun? Did you score? Did you play good defense? Who else on the team did well?
Good.
There's a lot of questions that you can ask that'll bring out the positive part in sports, not did you win? That's a negative thing for a lot of kids. They don't care about that, but the parents seem to be the ones that do.
Yeah.
So many children, they're just not exposed to the athletics. I talked to you a little bit earlier about a child that I know that is embarrassed to even go for a walk with his family because he can't make it. Mm-hmm. And there's so many children out there that are in that situation, that they're just sitting in front of the TV screen or the computer screen, and that's where they grow up. They have no physical activity at all, and that's why I think child obesity has tripled in the last 20 years or so. And it's like, we can't keep going down this course we're going down. And that's why we bring people like you on, to inspire people in the audience to involve their children and involve themselves in athletics and or just be active.
Well, you know, one of the things that I found really neat about Utah is that there are a lot of active people. My wife, she was a gymnast when she was younger. And she was active through college and was a cheerleader, actually, in college. And so she stayed very healthy and active. But after having a few children and working hard in the home and just pursuing her life as an adult and a mother, it got very easy to get away from going to the gym or staying active. And her father started walking in the mall in Orem, Utah. And I'd go with them on occasion. And it was the neatest thing. It would be middle of winter, cold outside, but they'd open the mall, and you'd walk on the inside of the mall, and there'd be dozens and dozens of people. Some of them were overweight. And I love seeing people that are overweight walking.
Trying to.
They're trying. And every time, and as I drive to school in Utah, it's a great thing, you see a lot of people out. There's like five or six ladies that live on the hill where I live. And every morning on the way to work, I wave to them, they wave to me. You know, they're having fun. It's good emotionally, it's good physically, it's good mentally. And it could be good spiritually if they're having a discussion about lifting their spirits while they're exercising. You get those endorphins going and
just
blood flowing, and it's a good thing.
Just the doing of it really lifts the spirit. And there's so much research now that shows it's so good for depression.
Absolutely.
And also, just the fact that they're out and trying and just enjoying the outdoors when that's possible.
Right. You know, and every once in a while I'll see, it looks like a husband and wife out early in the morning. That might be their only time where they can get out and get some fresh air and have an opportunity to talk to each other and at the same time get exercise. So they're kind of taking care of a lot of business in one great event.
And research also shows that if the mothers are active, then the children will tend to be. That's a tremendous influence on the children, is how active the mom is.
Oh, yeah.
Well, it's education. I think that we have an influence, an opportunity to lead as parents, and that's one area that I think a lot of parents don't know how to lead, and that is in physical activity, because if you're not educated or understand the principles of physical education or health, it's hard to teach your children. So that's why it's important to just learn the basics, just the fundamentals, to get you a long way.
Well, and particularly to be an example and live those yourself. Mm-hmm. Now, you stay in great shape. How do you do that with all the demands on your time?
Well, it's imperative in my life that I work out. I'm not crazy about it, but I try to work out at least 4 times a week. If I can get more than that, great. But my knees are a little sore from my professional career, so I go on a treadmill or an elliptical where I don't have to pound on the pavement,
uh-huh.
or I walk. And my wife and my children and I, a lot of times when I come home from work, we'll go for a walk. Now, I've already exercised for the day, but it's fun for me to get my wife and children and go at a pretty brisk walk. And for me, it works. Now, I have friends that run marathons and can do cross-country biking and all kinds of things, but it doesn't work for me.
I'm looking at my pedometer. I have 5,425 steps this morning. Had
this
a good
morning?
Walk, but I'll go again because I want to get my 10,000 steps.
Well, you know,
because that's just basic maintenance to get in 10,000 steps.
You know,
a day.
And one of the things that I see right now, Barbara, there's two aspects to it. One is you know the physical part of it is good for you. You know, as a physical educator, that it's going to help you. But the other thing is, I just saw you smile and a little spark in your eye that you have a little goal. You know, you want to get 5,000 steps in, and that kind of
10,000.
That's the emotional and the mental part that athletics or recreation can bring to your life.
Well, what we'd like to do now is we'd like to roll talking kind of about weight loss. Blanca she's done two segments. She's going to do a third segment for us. This is our last segment about weight loss, but it kind of targets some specific things that people can do both with exercise and with nutrition to help them with weight loss. So let's roll to that segment. Welcome to our third and concluding segment with Blanca on how to lose body fat, which everybody's interested in, I'm sure. What do you have for us today, Blanca?
Well, I would start with sodas, which is not really good for our body, soda or diet food, because if you see somewhere this is diet food or you can lose really fast, and Diet Coke, it just don't buy, stay away, stay far away from it, because it has so many chemicals in it that actually make you physically too addicted to, and you actually will gain weight back and more.
Yeah, that's what we talk a lot about that in the book. The diet is like a four-letter word. It's like, you know, we're not here to promote diets. We're here to promote healthy nutrition.
Yes.
Feeding your body things that are good.
Yeah, I don't think that people should keep strict diet, because if you go off the diet, you gain weight, and you cannot keep strict diet for all your life, because most of the diet, they are deprived from some things. I know that there is a high carbohydrate diet, a low carbohydrate diet, which carbohydrates are very important for our energy, so I don't really know how people keep diet low carbohydrates.
Yeah, your body has proteins, fats, and carbohydrates to choose from. The first thing it goes to is the carbohydrates, because that's the easiest thing for it to break down into glucose, which is your body's natural thing that it uses for energy. So it doesn't make sense to me to pull carbohydrates out of your diet when that's your body's favorite food.
Yes, that's true.
When we talk about the high glycemic index carbs, those are the ones like the sugars, the white flours. Those are the things that we should avoid, because they spike your blood sugar. And when your blood sugar spikes, your insulin, your pancreas releases insulin. Insulin does two basic things. It lowers your blood sugar and it pulls fat to your fat stores. So those things like white sugar
and
white flour, they'll make you fat because it causes that whole reaction in your body.
Yes, thank you to bring this up. That was my other suggestion, to limit the white flour and white sugar, because the white flour actually clogs up your digestive system and slowing down your metabolism. And as we said, and we are going to repeat again, that metabolism is very important, because metabolism helps to burn fat.
And a lot of people take artificial things like caffeine, or a lot of these nutritional companies used to add certain things that are now, like the ephedrine, that are now illegal, to basically race your heart to kind of try to speed up your metabolism. But that's not the best way to do it. The best way to do it is to eat healthy, to exercise, and to actually lower your resting heart rate and not take those stimulants. Because those stimulants, the caffeine I've been reading, actually will make you fat also.
Yes, and it's very dangerous for our body. It's just playing with our lives, and it never works. Never works. And I can tell from other people that they did it. I have friends that they were taking the ephedrine, yeah. They actually brought it from Russia. It was kind of business in my country for a while, so they just would take the ephedrine that would and drink coffee that would stimulate, as you said, and it's some people ended up in the hospital, so that's not fun to play game with your heart. It's very dangerous. Mm-hmm. And so we don't want that. We want to feel good. We want to have a lot of energy and still enjoy food.
Eat when you're hungry. You shouldn't starve yourself. If your body's hungry, you should feed it.
Yes.
Because it's saying, I'm hungry.
Yes. The other thing, I think that we always learn new things. Some books recommend to eat every 3 hours. Some books recommend to eat every 2 hours in order to speed up metabolism. And I think that it's good to have regular schedule that you eat, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And of course, if you get hungry, you can have some snack, fruit, or some dry food,
vegetables.
Yeah,
a lot of people, when they talk about eating every 2 or 3 hours, they're thinking, oh, I have to prepare this big meal every
yes.
2 hours, but that's not it.
That's not it. I think that we need time to burn fat, and so if we constantly eat, if we are eating constantly, there is no energy to burn fat, so our body is focusing on digestions.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that we should live maybe 5 up to 6 hours between the meals. It just depends how people wanna.
It depends on, I think, how active they are too. Like
yeah.
people that are more active, then they're going to need to eat more often. They're going to need to eat more food.
Yeah. Well, I eat 3 meals a day, and before I was eating every 2-3 hours, and whenever I went, I need to pack with me because I'm going to be gone for 4 or 5 hours. I don't do that anymore. And I found out that I have more energy than ever.
Well, a lot of it is because you're juicing. You're getting such high nutrient foods.
Yes. I drink 3 to 5 juices a day, and I have breakfast, lunch, and dinner, which is between like maybe 5 hours. And I work, and I'm really active between 12 to 16 hours a day. I'm on my feet at the moment in
like
my
six
life.
Like 6 hours a day in the kitchen, right?
Or more, almost all the time I'm in the kitchen. And I have more energy than ever. And I don't need to eat every 2-3 hours.
Well, you actually are eating that often because you're juicing 3 to 5 times a day plus your 3 meals. And those juicing routines, you're getting a lot of fruits and vegetables, right?
Yeah. Well, I drink my juices with my meal. So I don't actually do it between. I drink water, distilled
mm-hmm.
water, and teas.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I do between the meals.
Mm-hmm.
But as we said, we need energy, and our body needs that energy for focusing on burning fat.
Mm-hmm.
And so we don't want to load our tummy. I mean, if somebody's hungry, just go ahead and eat. We don't want anybody to starve. That's not a good idea. Because deficiency, it's very harmful for our body.
Well, one of the things we mention in our book is we say, do you go on a long trip and then fill up your car with gas, or do you fill up your car with gas and then go on a long trip? If you're going to be active, then you eat a larger meal, and then you can burn it off.
Yes. So let's go back to other principle. Eat organic apples all day. How do you say that? Do you have that in the United States? Eat the one apple a day and keep the doctor away.
Right.
So that's absolutely true. The apple, it's like full fibers and nutrients. So it's good to eat apples.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not that expensive. They're really good.
Right.
One trick that it's probably really good for everyone that I personally try on myself and I recommend it to my friend is before each meal, take 2 teaspoons of apple cider vinegar, organic raw apple cider vinegar. The vinegar has potential to help to burn fat, so it's kind of magic.
Mm-hmm.
And you can buy the big bottle, it's just $2 or $3. And one of my friends, she didn't change her diet. She ate actually pretty good, I mean, sometimes chocolate, sometimes sweet, and she started to do the vinegar, and she started to lose weight. So that's one good suggestion from me.
Cool.
For everyone who just try to keep up with with the weight problems.
Mm-hmm.
Other thing, eat the or add the black pepper or something spicy because that helps to speed up the metabolism.
So your body likes the spicy food?
Yeah, body likes the spicy food. Just be careful, you know, you don't want to overdo it because it can has kind of bad effect on the tummy wall, can get irritated. So be careful with spicy, but spicy foods or spices helps to speed up the metabolism. And the last one, which is very exciting, cheat whenever you want. If you really feel that, oh, you just can be without chocolate once in a while, or you're on the party and people have a, well, prepare your
I don't see you cheating that much, Blanca. I know you pretty well.
Well, I don't need to cheat because whatever I eat, I really love. I like whatever I eat. So, but if you like ice cream, go ahead and don't feel bad about it.
That's what we don't like saying people can't eat certain things, because I think it's really important that whatever nutrition program you're on, you feel like you're free. You don't feel like you're confined. Because if you feel like you're confined, you're not going to stick with it long term.
Yes.
And my basic thing that the Dr. Lockhart, you know, we teach in our book is that if you're consistently good, you can splurge and it's no big deal. But when people are consistently bad, then that's where you have problems.
Yeah.
A lot of times we go to parties and it's like, I eat a lot of the junk, and they're like, Tom, you have this health show, and you've written this book, but what are you doing? And I'm like, hey, I'm consistently good, and that's why I can splurge, and it's not a big deal.
Yes, yeah. We should enjoy it. Whatever we do, we should enjoy
our food.
And important things that don't feel bad about it. If you sometimes go off your eating or whatever,
don't beat yourself up
because the mind, it's very powerful and has an effect on
right.
it. Just cheat whenever you want.
Okay. All right, thank you. That's the end of our nutrition segment. We appreciate Blanca doing these segments for us, and I'm sure she has some great things in store in the future.
That's true.
Thank you very
much.
So Tom, do you ever splurge?
I do. I have a few vices.
Ice cream.
I mean, my family loves ice cream, and when they eat and I can't, no way, it doesn't work. So we celebrate our ice cream. I just know that if I keep working out and keep a balanced diet, that there's room every once in a while for a bowl of ice cream.
I'm glad we're like-minded on that one.
You talked a little bit on the break about some of the things you saw in the NFL. The players are getting so big, fast, and strong these days. It's like, I don't know who's getting together to breed these athletes, but it's like there used to be just a few people over 200 pounds. Now you have more than that, people over 300 pounds. And you say they're 15%, 18% body fat. How did you compete with these people?
Well,
and you were 185, right?
Right. I think I kept my weight down so I could run faster, but it's just, I think, the technology, the knowledge of diets now, the supplements, legal and illegal supplements, have made for bigger, faster, stronger bodies. And I heard a statistic not too long ago that there's like 300 plus NFL players that are 300 pounds. When I played, there were none. And so, you know, it was almost like it was a line that you couldn't cross. If you were over 300, you weren't healthy. Well, right now you have 300-pound players that have body fat percentages that are like 15-18%, which is excellent.
And they're running like 4.8 40s, right?
That's why this game, when I watch even college games now, I can't imagine that I played in that game or in that style, because I just don't, I didn't have the physicality that they do now.
I've often looked at you. We had class together, 15 years ago? And I think golfer, or I don't think football player. I still don't, even when I look at
it. I'll give you one quick funny story. We were at the Super Bowl, and I was a player, and we were coming from a practice into the team hotel, and they had security guards all around. And we had to come by, and we had security tags with our pictures, and I had somehow forgotten mine. And when I came through, just with the players, I was in line, one of the security guards grabbed me and said, "Excuse me, this is for the team only." I said, "I'm with the team."
And I'm on the team.
And you know how players are.
Yeah.
They just said, "No, I don't. That guy just jumped in line. He's not with the team."
Who's that?
They kicked me out of the hotel. So, you know, those practical jokes happen all the time. But I'm your least likely looking player.
But you said you made it because of the mental aspect.
Yeah, what was your edge?
Well, the NFL game, you have to have some degree of physical ability.
Right.
But there's varying degrees. The other part of that game is emotional and mental. And I learned early on that we had a very complicated system of defense and that I was never going to be the most physical, but I could be the best mental player on the defense.
So you found your strength.
And so that was my niche. I found it and I tried to highlight that, but at the same time continued to try to work. I didn't want my physical part to be a weakness.
No.
It just wasn't my strength.
But so then you found, in addition to the physical, you capitalized on the...
Absolutely.
You just studied and studied. Every...
Right. I mean, I think that everybody, it's just like I was saying before, we can't do everything, but everybody has something they can do well. And if you can find that, then it's going to help you out.
And that's really our whole focus, is the whole person, the body, mind, spirit, and not letting one get way out of balance.
Exactly.
But what you're saying is if you can find a strength and capitalize on that.
You know, when you talk about the spirit, it was a funny thing. When I was in college playing football and pro football, I used to love practice. And I'd come out to practice, and I was smiling, and the players used to go crazy. Like, what are you so happy about? We're practicing. You know, to me, I think it was attitude that, you know, this is what I do. This is my job. And if I can look at this in a positive vein and say, look, I'm going to come practice, and I'm going to get the most out of it, where other people would just dread coming to practice, and they practice like they didn't really like it. So there's another part of it. It's just, you know what? This is what I do. I feel good about it. You know, I think there's a purpose in me doing this. Let's just make the most of it.
And I love to wax philosophical, but to me, that's life.
It
life is.
Is
so great. Why not enjoy it?
Yeah.
And just be happy and make the most of it.
You know, now, there were hard times. I mean, the NFL, a lot of people think, oh, man, I would have loved to have been that. It's very hard.
What's the environment like? It seems to me it would be crude. Maybe women aren't treated with much respect.
You know, to a degree, you're going to see that. I think that it gets hyped out when you watch something on a movie about it. Every team in the league, every negative episode, they put into one movie,
yeah.
And that's not the case. But, you know, everybody has a choice into what they're going to do or not do, and that was my feeling right away. I was on a team where I really enjoyed the players and coaches, but there were some that had lifestyles that were very contrary to mine. And so I just made a decision. I'm not going to not like those people, but I just didn't partake in a lot of the things they did, and we got along just fine.
So you could keep your standards and not have to...
It was imperative because I noticed a lot of kids, young guys, would come in every year, and the first thing they'd want to do was buddy up with people that was the NFL lifestyle. Most people in the NFL aren't like that. But they would have this image or this visualization that it's a fast-paced life.
Uh-huh.
And most people that are successful in the NFL, they might come in doing harmful things, but they realize they're not going to stay very long. So they realize, this is my job, this is my profession, I better act like a pro. And so most of the time on successful teams, that garbage is gone.
Oh, that's great. That's good to know. And so you could have your own character and be true to that and not be despised or rejected,
right.
You could still be part of the team.
And Barbara, one of the great things about it was the 49ers during the 80s, where we won a number of championships, they celebrated good character. They drafted kids with character. They would not take players on the team that were kind of out there on edge, outliners. Even if they're great, they wouldn't take them because our owner and our head coach and our basic philosophy was, let's get the best players that we can with character, and you can establish something great over time. So when we had players that did the right thing, we were successful. When we had good players that went off on their own and had tangents that were harmful to the team, we lost. And that's how we were able to establish that over time.
Tom, I'm sure you're trying to do those same things with being an athletic director now, and you're over the men's and the women's programs. Maybe we can talk about that when we come back. We'd like to roll to Dr. Fraser's Ask the Doctor segment, so we'll be right back, and maybe we can talk about that.
Today we're going to be talking about headaches. Now, this is a problem that affects all of us, and I often talk about migraine headaches, but Dr. Fraser, you're saying they're three categories of headaches?
Yeah, Dr. Lockhart, there's three. The three most common categories of headaches are migraine, tension headache, and sinus headache. Mm-hmm.
And what do you do to differentiate?
Well, medically, I guess there's research indicates that, you know, there's probably 40 to 50 different versions of migraines, 40 to 50 different versions of tension. I mean, so there's all these big little subclasses within each one of those big categories.
Uh-huh.
But usually the migraine headaches are, you know, have a debilitating component to your vision, your taste or your sensory taste get goofed up, hearing possibly. You tend to want to go to dark, cold places. You tend to not want a lot of noise around you.
No
commotion,
light.
Things like that tend to get you.
Okay.
That's more the classic. Sometimes there's the visual disturbances that affect your eyes.
And when they get really bad, I know I become nauseous.
Nauseous, vomiting, shutting down. Most people just want to curl up in a corner and just die. It's, mm-hmm. it's many times the symptoms that they talk about during a migraine headache.
Now, what about sinus?
Well, the second most common headache is tension headache.
Tension headache.
Tension headache, and usually the tension headache is where you have all the pain mm-hmm. from the top of the shoulders, it goes into the neck, and just people just feel locked down all the time.
Your muscles
are tight.
A lot
of computer use, phone use, different things like that. The muscles mm-hmm. just stay tight, and they get a nagging headache that just does never go away.
Okay.
That's, and then, so from there, there's a lot of structural and a lot of musculoskeletal components that affect the tension headache. Also, a lot of people that do a lot of working out, bodybuilding, they get the larger traps, they get the different muscles. A lot of people that do sports and have sports injuries get their joints out of place and get things locked down. They'll develop the tension headaches from the same type of thing, from the musculature tightening up or having an injury on top of that.
And then
about the only time I notice I get headaches when I don't eat properly or I don't sleep properly.
Yeah, and then there's just the good old classic headache, which is you just get headache and you really can't associate it with any specific thing. Not eating properly, dehydration, or not getting enough of your nutrition in a balanced format, and definitely sleep, fatigue, exhaustion, those also do headaches. One of the most common things that if you look at and you read the side effects of medications,
mm-hmm.
what are the two things that almost all of them list? Dry mouth and headache.
Mm-hmm.
Well, dry mouth because it dehydrates the body systems internally, but also headaches because a headache is one of your first signs, whether it's the migraine, the tension, or the sinus, that your body's hurting. And that there's a major mm-hmm. illness or irritation or something affecting your nervous system, which is a master control system for your whole body. Sinus headaches, I know that's one of the things that also a lot of people get plagued about that have had a history of, you know, all kinds of illnesses that tend to get a lot of sinus headaches, and they tend to stay a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So they'll be on two or three courses of antibiotics, which doesn't promote health. But the sinus headaches will build up in the sinus areas, either below the eyes, above the eyes, or sometimes deeper back into the face or into the ethmoid sinuses. The sinus headaches put pressure into the cranial areas mm-hmm. and into the base of the cranial system, so it affects the neck as well. Those can be treated through chiropractic adjustments, acupuncture type care, as well as you want to get on some very proper herbs to get rid of the bacteria, the viruses.
So those are more chronic.
Usually they tend to go more chronic after there's other health conditions involved.
Okay.
But one of the most important things about the Ask the Doctor section that we want everybody to know is that migraine and tension headaches and sinus headaches and just your classic headache from ill health, you don't have to put up with them. And a headache is not a Tylenol or aspirin deficiency. Not to, you know, say that they don't help or they don't give relief, but they're not necessarily the fix.
Okay,
the
in other words, they may help just temporarily,
like a Band-Aid.
It's a Band-Aid
to get you through the moment.
Okay, but they're not going to be the cure.
They're not going to be the cure.
Okay.
All the research out there and all the clinical and statistical data, basically, with all three of the types of headaches, one of the most critical areas that we need to treat is the base of the occiput area, the upper part of the neck, because of the brainstem and the occiput and the skull sit on the neck. There are so many nerves that go up and in and down and through from the head mm-hmm. to the neck and back and forth. That's why most migraine headaches are triggered by a tension from the shoulders and neck.
Okay.
There's a lot of medications and different things people have tried to use or theories, but the simplest, most effective way to treat all three headaches in a natural form without drugs or surgery is to get the upper spine adjusted to keep the spine, the upper back, the neck in, and then also our cranium, our head bones. Because if we don't have our cranium in, our head aches, mm-hmm. and our cranium, our skull bones, protect our head. Dehydration, nutrition, whatever those are, it affects our cranium. So cranial work, cranial adjusting. Also, there's very wonderful herbs and nutrition to relax the tension out of our joints, our muscles. Some of the most common ones are valerian, magnesium, making sure you get your minerals in there. There's lots of wonderful things you can do, not just take the pharmaceuticals or the medications.
I would think things that we can do as far as massage would be really good too.
Massage, exercise, stretching, chiropractic, acupuncture, meditation. There's lots
even incorporating the wave into mm-hmm. people's mm-hmm. exercise program where they teach people how to relax, that releases that tension.
Relaxation therapies to help take the tension out of the body. Other than the sinus one, most all headaches start with some level of tension building or a toxicity issue. And that's why we talk about toxins. That's a whole other component, but a headache is many times a side effect of toxin buildup.
So we may not be rid of headaches. We may expect someday to get a headache.
Right.
But now we have an idea of what to do when we get a headache other than just
options.
Take a pill.
Options, yes.
Okay.
One of the most important things, too, when you get a headache is realize your body's trying to talk to you.
Good.
You need to get information. You need to understand why it's trying to talk to you, not just say, oh, it just must be a little bit of stress and take a simple Band-Aid type remedy.
Or to take it and just keep going.
Or to put up with it and keep going, exactly.
Yeah. And we talk about that so much on our show, that when your body's hurting, don't work through the pain, don't take something to mask it, but look to the cause of the problem. And if you address the cause of the problem, then long term you can get rid of the problem.
One of my favorite phrases is, address the cause, not chase the symptoms. That's something that we repeat all the time in the clinic. It's something that if the general healthcare of society understood that, start addressing causes instead of chasing symptoms, the general wellness of everybody would improve.
That's awesome.
And I can tell you that's exactly what you've done for me, is he goes right to the cause. He doesn't just treat the symptom.
Thanks, Dr. Fraser.
Thank you.
We'll be back in a minute.
So, Tom, playing in the NFL, you never had any headaches, did you?
Oh, I had quite a few.
A defensive back where you're hitting people with your head.
It's kind of a scary thing because back in those days, they didn't have the understanding medically of concussions and the total number of that you get. Right now, you get 3 or 4. They don't let you play. And, you know, I played with guys, and I probably had 6 or 7 or 8. And they didn't. You get dinged, and they'd say, oh, you got dinged. They didn't call it a concussion. There was a ding, and then you got knocked out. When you got knocked out, that was a concussion.
Now, you mentioned you dealt with headaches more when you were actually coaching, and you weren't exercising, and you're letting the tension get to you?
Well, I think that I learned that I tried to push too hard and burn the midnight oil, and I didn't exercise because I didn't have time in the day, I thought. And physically, I was just deteriorating because there was so much external pressure and internal pressure. And so I realized, you know, I had terrible tension headaches. So I realized when I was working out, you could get the blood flowing and it mentally and emotionally straighten myself up, then I had less headaches. So I figured
Isn't
it out.
Isn't that great? It goes along with everything we always talk about.
Now, you had success after success, and then you ran into some rough times. What kind of perspective has that given you now?
Well, you know, it's interesting. It was really, I got cut when I played. I mean, I got fired when I played for a short period of time. They brought me right back. And then I got fired when I was coaching at Cal after 6 years. And it's interesting that I had never really had any failures in my life from the time I was a little kid, always on championship teams. And you know what? I didn't think I was ever going to fail. And then when I did, it kind of put my life into perspective that, you know what? What everybody says, you walk down the road of life, there's going to be some trials. I just didn't have any.
Some rough bumps.
I had to learn how to adapt to that, and it helped me. And now, as I go through life, I'm a little bit more compassionate for people. And I realize that, hey, I got to make good choices that are going to keep me to my core, my principles that I believe in, and the way I live my life. And so one of those is exercise. Keep yourself physically fit so you can be emotionally and mentally straight.
It just gives you such a perspective, and not to put so much stock on what happens each day and this life or death, if one thing happens or another.
And you would know, the two of you, you've played competitive athletics, and we get pushed to go down that road where it's almost addictive competitiveness. And, you know, no one likes to win as much as I do, but right now I have it in perspective. You know, when I don't win, it's not the end of the world, but it's not about winning, it's about being the best I can be. But I want to be good.
And when you look at the whole picture, you have your love for your God, for your Savior, your family. I think you just start to put all this in perspective.
That's helped me probably the most. You know, I thought I could do it on my own, but when I was on rock bottom, when things were not going well for me at Cal as a head coach, I had to count on my prayers. There was I couldn't do it on myself. And that was the first time when I finally had to say, look, Tom, you can't do this by yourself. You're not quite as strong as you thought you were. And that helped me a great deal. And that's really what put it in perspective. I just kind of, I didn't give up, but I gave it over, you know, to the Savior and said, look, I'm okay. I'm way better off with you running it than me.
Well, Tom, we're going to roll to a friend of yours, Karen's segment. She's going to talk about massage, and maybe you can come back and tell us a little bit about how you know Karen. So
this will be a great segment.
This will. So let's go to that one.
Karen, I'm trying to be serious, but you just told Tom to take his shirt off. And he did, but you said he could keep his pants on. But here we are again. Now this time, Tom, you're lying down on the job. Karen, what do you have for us now?
We're going to be doing a 5-minute demonstration of massage on the upper torso. And so, Tom, you just can let the world go away, and I'll just be explaining what I'm doing. The most important thing when you are beginning a massage, and before I start there, I'm going to have you putting your thumbs exactly where they are. This is for grounding. This keeps him grounded during the massage. And if you have two people, it's so fun. Or you can do foot massage, but it feels so good to the person laying on the table because they feel all that human connection. We need more therapeutic touch. And the world has gotten a little confused thinking that sexual touch is exactly what we need. Mm-hmm. Really, the babies, and they find babies in ICU units dying for lack of touch. Mm-hmm. The human spirit needs touch. Nurturing the spirit segment, that's what we're talking
and
about.
And it is today. A shame that all touch has a sexual connotation, because it doesn't at all. It's what you're saying.
Exactly. Yeah. We need more hugs. We need more purity mm-hmm. in our intent. Mm-hmm. And so today I'm just going to demonstrate for you a few massage strokes, so that Tom can go into deep relaxation. Massage is wonderful for toning. It's really nice to have one of these little holsters, because you can buy these at body workshops and stores. And the oil that I use is olive oil. Olive oil is a fruit oil and conducts electricity. And guess what? I am his electricity at this moment, because I have electrical currents. We all have electrical currents. And so we're sending in energy. Never want to go to a therapist who is depressed, because they will deplete your energy and drain you. So I'm in a good mood, so you're okay. We're going to put some unfailing love, which is the blend with rose, lang lang, orange, patchouli, sandalwood. These oils are for healing the heart, healing the mind. And I can come under here and let him take some big deep breaths. Typically in a massage, I don't like to talk a lot, believe it or not, because it gives the mind an opportunity to go into that theta state and really heal. Okay, so we're going to demonstrate connecting. I'm connecting to Tom. Connecting to his spirit.
Life has wearied your mind. Of solace, come seeking, you shall find. Healing hands can sift your troubles as grains of sand. This heartache you are feeling, God and
often I do sing to my clients
understand.
Because it helps them to connect to a human voice. To the tones of the human voice are very healing.
Time for unwinding, unravel fear by fear. Healing hands can sift your sorrows. Gaze into his eyes, cause sunshine.
The music that I've written is all Christ-centered, all about the atonement of Christ. He is our healer. Without him, there is no permanent healing. So helping the client to, no matter what his faith is, to connect to the Savior. Big deep breath, Tom.
slow strokes. Help the body to go into deeper relaxation. Massage helps to tone, bring circulation, increase circulation to the specific point that you are massaging. A lot of times you'll see the flesh turning pink or red. Most of all, I think therapeutic massage with a pure intention nurtures the spirit, which is much deeper than skin. My daughter said, if everybody got 15 minutes of this a day, there'd be no crime, Mom.
How old is your daughter?
She's 16.
Oh, how sweet. How many do you have?
I have four.
Four. Two girls, two boys?
Two girls, two boys. My oldest daughter is a massage therapist and was at Half Moon Bay at a five-star hotel.
It's relaxing just watching.
When we were in school, it was amazing because when we were watching the teacher teach, we'd all be going into theta state going, oh, just watching the demo on the table. I have lots of clients now, husbands and wives, who are doing this with their children. And it's wonderful to see that something so bonding can be done in a way that helps families heal. His peace is the gift to
set his children free. We could have you do this all day.
I could do it all day.
Well, I hope our viewing audience hasn't just totally gone to sleep. We're here visiting with Tom Holmoe today. Tom, we had class together years and years ago, and I've just always thought of you as such a classy individual. And what do you attribute? You just have such a wonderful air about you. Today I worry because we get so casual in our dress, in the immodesty, and casual in our language. I can't picture you cussing someone out. I mean, you're just a classy guy.
Well, I appreciate that, bro. I think that, I have two parents that were raised me to, you know, do the right thing and have some dignity and show a little class. But I think, the parents, especially today, but maybe in all times, parents need to instruct their children how to behave, how to act. Because, you know, there's a difference between just not doing wrong and doing right. And, I don't try to impress people. I think you just try to be friendly and you try to serve people. And if you can serve people, then you can build a relationship. And to me, I just love people. And that's why coaching was good for me, because I just love one-on-one, working with players, working with other coaches, you know, going out and talking to boosters. It's about strengthening and building relationships. And it's hard to build a relationship with someone when you can't connect. And the only way to connect is to listen and, you know, don't give them any reason to think that you're a jerk.
Because it isn't an air. I mean, it's just natural. You can tell it comes from your core.
Well, thank you.
Core.
And, I appreciate that about you, too. We go back a ways, and it's always good to see you.
Now, what's your relationship with Karen? You guys grew up in the same?
Yeah.
You were in junior high together?
Karen moved into my community in junior high. And we became friends immediately and have stayed friends for a long time. Now, we haven't kind of been left out of touch for a while, but on occasion we reconnect, and it's like we just go right back to where we were back many, many moons
and
ago.
And what a personality.
She's got a great personality.
And even in junior high.
Yeah.
She sang and wrote.
The thing is, when kids come to new schools, it's stereotypical. They get in a shell and there's no friends and woe is me. Her first day of school, she came and she was going to meet people. And she did. And, you know, I love her for that. She's just a terrific person.
Now, Tom, what are you trying to do at Brigham Young University in your athletic program? You're in charge, we talked about earlier, the men's and the women's. What's your main objective?
Well, my main objective is to take care of the 536 student athletes. And I give you that number. I don't say we have a lot. We have 536. And if I say that, then it reminds me that there's individuals. And instead of grouping them in big teams or one big department, I think that each one of them has needs. And we have administrators and coaches and trainers and doctors and equipment managers and all academic advisors. We have a lot of support people around them. I don't want anybody to fall through the cracks. So we try our best to organize ourselves so that we take care of those individuals and help them to reach their full potential.
Now, you saw an outstanding program at Stanford. I think Stanford's won the Sears Cup.
They have.
How many years in a row?
12 in a row.
Which is what? The best overall program in the country. How do we get there?
Well, it takes time. And I witnessed Stanford at the beginning, how they developed those programs. It took a long time to raise the funds and the awareness. They have an integrated men's and women's program, like we do now, but they cheer for each other, they encourage each other, success breeds success. When the men's swimming wins, the women's swimming wins. When the women's tennis wins, the men's tennis wins. And when volleyball wins, football wins. So they look at it as a team, one team. And one of our major goals is unity, unifying what once was two departments, two successful departments, by the way. And it's hard. It's change. And it's hard. People don't like change, and you have to adapt to it. But we're trying to earn the respect of each other so that we can work together and have a great future.
Well, I'm sure BYU is so lucky to have you just because of all the different places you've been groomed, you know, through the years. And so I'm sure that we can feel what a great person you are and that BYU is lucky to have you.
Well, I appreciate it. You know, it's funny. My dad, when I was playing in the NFL, said, "You're the luckiest man in the world. You've never had a job in your life." I said, "Dad, this is a big job." And now that I'm in athletics as an administrator, because I get to go to games and work with athletes and coach coaches, he still thinks I don't have a job. But I
don't think you have a job either.
To a degree, you're right. I think every human being or everybody who works would love to love their job. And I love my job, so I'm very fortunate.
It's so great.
So thank you so much for coming. We're so excited to have you on, and we appreciate your spirit and the things you brought to this discussion. So
thank you. I appreciate what you're doing. And I just hope that more people will watch, that your listeners and viewers will say, "Hey, these guys got something good going. You should watch." So let's get going.
Thanks,
next week what we have Mark Kassman on. He's written two books entitled The Drug of the New Millennium and Healing the Heart and Healing the Mind. And that is dealing with pornography. And it's a critical issue. It's gone from $1 billion per year about 15 years ago. Now it's up over $50 billion per year. So it's a huge issue that families and women and children and fathers are dealing with. And so that's why we wanted to address that issue. But and then we have Lavelle Edwards coming on in a couple of weeks and his wife, Patty. And then we have Greg Olson and Sid Olson that are coming on here the week after that.
Beautiful art.
The
Savior.
Well-known Christian artist.
Art. We're tackling some tough subjects. We're going to do pornography next week.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is...
But it's such an important issue, and anyway, we love our show, right? It's a great show.
So you love what you do.
Yeah, we love what we do.
So, we thank you so much for tuning in. We love you. We appreciate you. And tell your friends about GAGA for Healthy Living. Thank you.